Pradeep Kargil, Dr. Gayendra Sharma, and Dr. Adarsh Mehta on the topic Discordance of Technology and Medical Education.
The Honorable Chairperson for this session is Dr. Abdul Latif Sheikh Sir, Ex-Professor and Head of Department of Respiratory Medicine. Now we request the Chairperson of this session to kindly come on the stage and accept our welcome. Kindly welcome our guest of honor of this panel discussion. Sir, please.
Under observation, practically. your unit in charge is checking the patient, at the same time he is describing you different signs or he is describing you the symptoms what the patient has, he will give you the importance of speaking. So, in other fields, in my opinion, AI can be of very useful. Now, before going into the discussion, we will see how we classify the artificial intelligence. Number one, depending on capabilities. How we classify them? Narrow AI, general AI, and super AI. Narrow AI, I can give you example, if simple example is Siri. Siri, you must be knowing, no? That is narrow AI. He is designed to understand something and he may respond to you correctly or may not respond to you correctly. That is very narrow AI. Second is general AI. General AI can understand, it can learn intellectual tasks a human being can do. Then it will apply the knowledge, and the example is a computer developed by physician. And super AI is something which surpasses the human intelligence. In my opinion, it is just a hypothesis. On artificial intelligence, how can depend on the functionality? How they function? Reactive machines. That means they are trained for something. Example will be the, you must be knowing, IBM's QD. What about it? He was able to win against Gary Kasparov. Okay? He is designed to play only the chess. The thing is, Kasparov can, if he wants, he can play also cricket. Kasparov can play boxing. This cannot be done. So this is the limitation of these reactive machines. We are designed them to react to something. This view is designed to react to a specific move done by Kasparov. This is reactive machine. Second is limited theory machine. The example is self-driving cars that has been developed by Elon Musk. Self-driving cars. They have limited experience. They will remember only about the lanes, they will remember only about the signals, they will remember or they get the directions from Google Map or something else and they will know. This is the limited theory. Then next is the theory of mind. It is the advanced class technology. They will just understand the environment and the example is the Sophia. Have you seen Sophia? Yeah, that is the example of theory of mind. So you can understand something. And last is the self-awareness machine. That means they are self-aware. They will try to learn from themselves and they will take the decisions. And their decisions may be useful or they may be harmful to the community depending on the understanding of the machine. The example of this is Terminator 3. Have you seen the Terminator 3? Skynet program that wants to control the world. Isn't it? It developed on its own. It wants to control the world using the satellites which are there in that case. And again, this is hypothetical. Now, as far as my knowledge goes, we are using AI. Have you seen the hematology cell analyzers? Yes. We are using the hematology cell analyzer and the few machines, they suggest to the diagnosis. Remember, few machines, they suggest to. For example, they will give yes, microcytosis. They will give a typical lymphocytes. Again, the machine has its own limitation. I always teach the student, the cell counter, greatest strength of the cell counter is the single value is given. A single value. MCV, it will give a single value. Platelet count, it will give a single value. That is the strength. But the limitation, see, The limitation of that machine is the commonest type of anemia in our setting is nutritional. They have deficiency of iron, they have deficiency of folic acid and B12. This machine will calculate the size of thousands of RBCs and find out the average. In case of nutritional anemias, the patient is anemic and it will give the LCV value as a normal one. Again, you have to see the case and determine which type of anemia is. Another example is microcytosis. It will give low LCV. Microcytosis can be because of n number of conditions. N number of conditions. It can be seen with thalassemia, it can be seen with iron deficiency anemia, it can be seen with chronic blood loss. The machine cannot tell. It will just say that a microcytic anemia is there and there is a place for human. So, in my opinion, a supervised learning is always best because how we develop AI, we depending on our past experiences, we create the algorithms. Create different algorithms depending on the past experiences and the experience of each clinician, each center is different. The experience of a specialized neurology center in case of CNS cases will be different. The experience of a person working at a secondary or tertiary hospital, they will be different evaluation. And if we use data, in my opinion, it will not be useful. Second is, if you read this about AI on Medscape, you will find that past history, taking a history is very important to come to a conclusion, which this AI cannot be useful. Now, where this AI can be useful? For example, few Mayo clinics and like that, they have developed their chatbots. Definite set of questions and definite answer. A patient is discharged after X surgery. He has some questions in mind. And as soon as we go to that chatbot, he will list all the questions, probable questions from their experience. You click that question and the answer is coming. Same is true about our income tax department is also using a chatbot. But it is useful for how should I file the return. For complex filing of the return, many times we require someone who is expert in that field. Dr. Sharma to comment. He has more experience. He is a surgeon and the artificial intelligence or robotics have developed most in the surgical fields.
Thank you, sir. First of all, I am thankful to all of you for giving me an invitation. Initially, I thought I am a misfit in this particular discussion because I am not attached to any teaching institute. But when I had a talk with Dr. Rohit, he insisted that you come. I have certain views about the use of medical technology or technology in medicine. And when I say medicine, it is all branches of medicine. Right from UG level to your clinical practice. Now, as I gather, most of you are from first year. So, I would not try to give you too many examples about what is in clinical practice. But I would give few of my thoughts about use of technology in medicine. Now, let us begin with the first basic thing that you all experience, that all your lectures are taken on multimedia. Am I right? Yeah. And I was told that this is the concept by the university that all lectures should be on multimedia. And this is what I always thought would be great. You have a PowerPoint presentation, you have crisp diagrams which are in 3D imaging, you can have videos and you can make the concept very clear for students. For anatomy, you can have videos where even dissection is shown. But you talk to people, and let's not take it on a personal level, but you talk to
gamut of students across our country, are they happy with the way things are being taught? And they would say 80-20. 20% of the times they are happy, 80% of the times they are not happy. And I think it also follows what is called as the Pareto's principle, that it always follows the 80-20. Now why this happens? I will give you an example told to me by a student from AIIMS Delhi. I am not talking about students from Solapur or anywhere else. AIIMS Delhi is supposed to be one of the premier institutes. It is the premier institute in India for that matter. And he said, I think it's not the job of the teachers to read excerpts of PDF which they have copied and pasted in the thing. Now what this brings about is that medical technology is always a boon as well as a pain. And any technology, unless it is used in a right way, it's not going to be true. Whether it is for teaching, whether it is for diagnosis, whether it is for anything else. Regarding the teaching part, you people must have given your initial term anyway, and you must have realized that your exams are very different from the exams that you have ever given in your life so far. And suddenly, all of you who have scored so well in NEET start getting the fear that whether you are going to clear the exams in the first go. Doesn't this fear come to you? Now, the basic difference between the way teaching comes about in our and the way evaluation is done here and evaluation is done outside the country, like in places like United States or UK, is we tend to rely a lot on fact-based learning, while in the West the emphasis on analytical abilities. And this is where the concept of AI and other things come, because we feel that they are able to analyze things in a much better way. I do not know what the future holds in store for us, and as Dr. Gardner sir mentioned, that if super AI comes, which is still hypothetical, they might be able to analyze things in a better way. But as things stand today, it is, I would say, a glorified version of ego. Garbage in, garbage out. What does ChatGPT do? What does any algorithm do? It collects all the information that is available in the top-notch literature that is available, and based on that it comes to a conclusion. So if the information fact is fallacious, the results will be fallacious. Because medicine has changed. To give you an example, there is a condition called as vesicoureteral reflux. In 1950s and 60s, there was a urologist in US called as Cohen, who came up with a very simple operation. And he also found that 45% of the patients who underwent surgery for the vesicoureteral reflux, where the urine goes back into the kidney while the patient is voiding, 45% of these patients, their siblings are also having this reflux. So it became a pattern that all the siblings underwent a radiological evaluation, and if they had reflux, they underwent the surgery. Till 10 years later, people found out that this is not needed. This doesn't serve any purpose. So if AI would be present at that particular point of time, it would have said, algorithm wise, first degree relative, do MCU, reflux, undergo surgery. But when people applied their mind and they came up with a logical conclusion that reflux need not be treated surgically in all cases, the surgery is disappeared. This conclusion, where humans have come up with a conclusion that reflux does not damage the kidney, these are these analytical areas where artificial intelligence could be more useful. Regarding the fact that we are using technology, few areas where I feel technology should be dominantly used. One is in teaching, where different aspects should be shown to the students. You can show different surgeries right at the beginning. I don't know if anybody is from second year or third year, there is a surgery for prostate called as Player's prostatectomy. This was the commonest surgery which was done when I was a student here. And in this surgery, I remember till I joined MS General Surgery, the only thing I remembered was the surgeon putting a finger in the bladder, doing some maneuvers and coming out with the prostate. Until I myself did that surgery, I never understood what exactly what prayers possible. So these aspects can be shown to the people. Once you are into clinical practice, the data storage is done by computer, but the data analysis can be done in a much better way. And why in a country like India this becomes important, and about this I have a very strong opinion. You look at the two most populous countries in the world, that's China and India, and India might probably surpass China. And what do? We follow guidelines which are given by people from UK whose population is less than that of Maharashtra. We follow guidelines given by United States of America. Everybody, US is dominating the medical field at present. And their disease pattern, their genetic behavior, their body behavior is markedly different from that of the Indian population. Are we lacking in brains? No. Are we lacking in hard work? No. We are lacking as far as accumulating the data and analyzing it is concerned. And then we can come up with our own guidelines, our own algorithms, which need to be followed by people across the world and not the other way. This is something which is coming in a very slow but steady way. I was recently discussing with few of the students now that the recent edition of Love and Delhi, the prime textbook for general surgery students or even in third MBBS, the entire section of genitourinary system except for one chapter is written by Indian urologists. There are chapters in Campbell's urology which are written by Indian urologists. So we Indians are making a mark in every aspect of our medical field, but where we are lacking is having a combined data which can be analyzed using the newer tools so that we come up with certain things. The classical example which I can think of is, during this COVID era, had there been a very cooperative effort on part of all the different medical agencies to pull that data in a systematic way, probably all that confusion which lasted for 6 months, that it goes by contact and then finding out that it is airborne spread and the differences in the treatment, that time would have been cut down by half and lot of lives would have been saved. So I would take this opportunity to say that embrace technology, but remember that don't follow or ape that whatever is new is best, because whenever anything is new, whenever you have a new hammer, everything looks like a nail. Everybody talks about robotic. अरे क्या किया? Robotic nephrectomy, robotic pyeloplasty, robotic radical prostatectomy. But when you talk to lot of people who analyze the thing, robotic is excellent when it comes to doing a radical prostatectomy, a surgery which is done for CA prostate, because prostate is situated just behind the pubic symphysis. For any human to reach there, move his hand in a very difficult way, make the anastomosis between the bladder and the urethra is very difficult. But the robot with the arm where it can move a lot can do the job in a much better way. But at the same time, it doesn't mean that anybody who has a robot will be able to do the surgery equally well. I will tell you the words of an associate professor of urology who dominantly does robotic surgery in one of the premier institutes of India, and he said that I do robotic radical prostatectomy and I have seen few of the great names in urology doing it, but the best radical prostatectomy that I have seen has been done in an open way. And that made me remember a word, a quote that I famously remember, I forget the name of the person, that good results of surgery are results of good surgery. And lot of the newer modality, especially when it comes to technology, gets industry. Another example about which I think a lot of analysis needs to be done is that doing robotic surgery, say example of robotic pyeloplasty. robotic balloplasty. You know the time taken for any surgeon who is the world's best surgeon for robotic balloplasty is not less than 3 to 5 hours. And the same surgery is done by open surgery within 1 hour. We have a very prominent anesthesiologist, Agarwal madam here, and she would be the best person to comment about, does not general anesthesia extending over 4 hours make a difference compared to something which is only for 1 hour? So, does it mean that it's bad? No. Robotic surgery is excellent in certain fields. So, likewise, every technology is good and bad. Like it is happening in our way of, in our society, that we try to think that whatever comes from the West is fantastic. It's not so. Here, we don't need artificial intelligence. We need our intelligence to find out what is good, what is better, and what will be best for our people, our society. And at the end, I would like to say that when it comes to use of technology, we make a primary error. If any of you are fond of reading Arthur Conan Doyle and Sherlock Holmes, if I quote it rightly, it is in a chapter of The Scandal in Bohemia, where he talks to his mate, Dr. Watson. He says that the common error that people make is they put theory before the facts. You need to have facts in hand and then form a theory which can be applied. We need to use our intelligence to gather the facts. We need to use the technology to analyze these facts in a better way, to formulate theories which can be used for the betterment of students, developing good doctors, and at the end, help the society have a good, healthy life. Thank you so much.
Before going to that, I will just give my own experience where hands-on training is very important. Remember that most of the students are the first candidates and do as much dissection as possible. We have students from foreign universities where the dissection is demonstrated to them on a body, human body, and they practice it on a Google body or something like that. Very simple. I have a dissection, they do on a Google body. We have students in pathology from such foreign universities, and then they are asked, or they have to do the autopsies actually on a body, they find it very difficult. They don't know how much pressure or the force I have to apply to the scalpel. Many a times it happens that they apply such a large pressure, the great vessel gets dissected and there is 5 liters of blood in the cavity. Nothing they are able to identify. They are not able to identify any artery or nothing else. So, hands-on training, this artificial intelligence, I am discussing about the medical education, different parts of medicine. Hands-on training is must only, dissection is must. Actual feel, how much pressure I have to apply to the skin to cut it. How much, for example, we do the costochondral dissection here to reflect the sternum and to go into the chest cavity. How much? So I will not dissect or give a cut to the heart or lung which is situated. And most of the time, these foreign students, they give such a pressure that in a single stroke, left costochondral junctions are cut as well as the heart is cut also, including the lung, adjacent lung. This is very important. That's why, and I find that those students from those colleges where hands-on dissection is allowed today, they are better at dissecting. In the Google body, you get the force of coronary arteries very correctly. I have done minimum 1,000 dissections of the heart, and I find that each time the force is different in each and every case. In each case, we have to study left coronary artery, anterior descending, circumflex, right coronary artery. Even after doing 1,000 autopsies, even I get a fear in my mind whether I will be able to find the right coronary because a pad of fat is there. A big pad of fat is there. Book says, it comes out, goes across the right border and so on, superior border and so on. It is located. In every case, we will find that it is located at some another period. And I have to consult Dr. Tularisa. He is consultant for the autopsy girl. I have to consult him. Sir, how should I decide this? He will come and he will tell me, he will read, go to the books. So what I want to say is, hands-on training is always important in medical education, we are saying. I am talking about medical education. Data analysis, as Sharma sir said, yes, AI is perfect for data analysis.
I would just take this point further. The difference that I have seen over the years, like I take clinic for BMA and MCA students online. And when we were students, the pattern used to be the student tells the history, then there is examination, then there are investigations. So the viva goes, there is right sided loin pain from 2 days. What will you do? The next question is ultrasound. They don't tell that we will examine the patient. So, if you do ultrasound, you do CT scan, you do MRI, as my boss used to say, you do all investigations, then over a period by evolution, your mind will undergo atrophy. So, whatever it is, always remember that as students of medicine, you come in touch with the human being, where no amount of artificial intelligence, unless it is robo part 2 Chetty, where he has some emotions. The emotional connect that you should develop with your patients can never be developed through technology or AI. Okay.
First of all, I want to thank the organizer who has brought me for this event. I think now nothing left when two of my very much learned professors at teachers, my own teachers are there, they have told everything about it. I can just summarize it. I can't tell you anything new because they have covered practically everything. It is, a technology is actually a two-sided sword. We have to use it wisely. And what sir has told us is very important. Whatever the technology comes, as we used to say previously, the machine is important. But the man behind the machine is equally important. So here is the technology, what we are having. But as we all know, whatever the technology comes, or whatever the report from AI-based tools or ultrasound or anything, all investigation modules, one line at the bottom is always written, a clinical correlation. So that means whatever we go or whatever we get the knowledge from this technology, we have to know how to correlate it clinically. Otherwise, see, there are so many ample evidences available where even I have faced, you know, one of my relatives where MRI has given if there is an abscess in paraspinal area, and I have opened the patient. And finally, I came to know that there is nothing inside exactly at the same level. And then, when I have read literature and discussed so many things, they told me MR hyperestimates fluid and even the muscle edema can be shown as an abscess. This is what I have seen in my own patient. So that indicates the clinical, that time I can tell you, at that time I should have confirmed it before doing the open surgery by tapping. By doing a tapping, if I would have tapped and if I got anything, if there is some liquid, then I would have opened it. That means whatever, anything which comes from the investigations, all these investigation models are nothing but the AI or intelligence or technology, what we are talking about. But how to correlate it clinically, it is equally, and it is most important thing to give the final output to the patient. Secondly, in part of education, whatever we have taught and whatever we are learning and whatever I have learned is now definitely it is 30 years back, 30 years down the track it has been changed. If we are using this all these recent modalities and recent technology for the education part, I can just tell you one important thing. This is very important. When I was in MS, second year, it was my second year in MS, and one our department's PG exam was going on. Dr. Patam sir from MGIMS Vardha, he came as an examiner, and after looking the instruments on the table, he asked me to call, ask for where is have you not kept a Denham P? Why I am trying to tell you, this is very important. He has asked me to why didn't you keep a Denham P? I just came to him and I told him, sir, I know about Durham P, but I'm not aware of Denham P. So he told me, go and bring it. So I brought it from the podium given it. So he told me, it is not Durham P, it is a Denham P. See, why I am trying to tell you, our seniors have taught it as a Durham P. There wasn't anything for me to correct myself. Now you have got this technology to correct yourself.
Yeah, that's very important.
That is very important. See, for 2 years I was calling it as a Durham P. It is nothing. I am not saying keep calling something as a wrong or something like that. But now the technology, what you are available, you can correct yourself at any moment because of the available of technology. But previously, what our seniors used to tell or what we learn it from books, if at all we want to correct ourselves or learn anything new, we have to go to the library, we have to research for the whatever the references or whatever the references available, and then we used to get that knowledge. But right now, it is now available for you within a fingertip. You can see or you can apply your knowledge whatever at whenever it is available at you available for you at any time. Lastly, I can just tell you for first year students, whenever you are using this is in your in a medical particularly in education part or in the learning part, see books. The books are going to be the mainstay. Technology is going to help you, but the books will help you while giving exams. I can just tell you. Because so many things are available on the net, or you can even have your notepad, or you can have your books in a PDF format. But when you try to correlate too many books or too many references, you must have some standard textbook from which, from all the places you can collect and put your notes in one place. Whenever you are going for exam, you can revise that. I am not saying that technology will not help you, but I will just tell you that it's like a how to correlate and how to consolidate. That is one of the important thing. Technology is going to be the future, and one of our pathologists has told us that time. Any new thing which comes, we always say that we no, it is not good. First 2-3 years, 5 years always says it is not good. Then after 5 years, we start searching the bad things out of it. And after 5 years, we accept it. But at that time, it is already late, something new has been done. So, technology is to be used wisely and technology has to be accepted in a broad way. And we always try to see what is good and bad in it. We should always see even how it is going to help us and how it is going to improve my clinical acumen. That is very important. Technology to improve your clinical acumen, if we use it, then it is going to be helpful. I really thank you all again, and I'm just handing over to you,
sir. And one more thing. Most of the speakers, I will say a little negative towards it. But definitely, in medical field, it has a value, especially when I am analyzing something based on the science. Example I can use is the cervical dysplasia scale. How I say, I look at the size of the cell, I look at the size of the nucleus, the INC ratio change in the or immaturity of the cytoplasm, I report it as a dysplasia. Now, this can be converted into AI. I am sure that is the machine which will screen thousands of cervical psychologist pick up the abnormal. Same can be true about efficiency in finding out normal XHS. AI is very efficient to say that this XHS is definitely normal. Here, for a large screening, we can use it. Use this AI. Next application, positive application, is next generation sequencing. Now, next generation sequencing will give you thousands of mutations in one tumor, hundreds of mutations. Few are important from the clinical point, and the bioinformatics, which is embedded in next generation sequencing machine, will give you these are the mutations which you can treat, and the drug give the name of the available drug for the same. Now, this is the advantage of artificial intelligence. I cannot go on identifying each mutation, its clinical significance. Again, second and third. As you must be knowing, or you are in the first year, those who are in second year, they must be knowing that malignancy is nothing but accumulation of abnormal mutations. A single mutation cannot lead to malignancy. It is the accumulation. And one concept is oncogenic addiction. That means on one mutation, the life of a tumor depends, and you can treat that mutation and the disease can be controlled. The example is the CNA. Tyrosine kinase pathway is affected. We treat it with imatinib, and the patient's life is sometimes they say cured, but prolonged.
Thank you. Because the artificial intelligence, new things are going to come up in medicine in all sectors like that. They are coming in medicine, but this artificial intelligence should not replace our natural intelligence, because that will not replace. But we should not stop using our natural intelligence, because if we stop using nowadays, what we are doing, tables we are not using. Or is it going for calculator and using that for multiplying so many things? So day by day we are not using our brain. That is bad. So we should keep on using our natural intelligence. That is very useful. And what is this coming, new things are coming? That is for only for our assistant. They should not replace our intelligence. Then it will be useful. There will be advantages and disadvantages. And nowadays, whatever is there, that is not a problem for us now. But they are going for next step. So they are making the machine, they are giving the intelligence to the machine. Machines are idiots, they don't know anything. We are making them wise. We are giving them intelligence. That is what artificial intelligence is there, what we are giving to the computers. Now they are going for the first step. They want the computer or the machine to take decisions like human brain takes. That is dangerous, because they may take wrong decision, or they may try to supersede human race. That thing is dangerous. So whatever we have to do is that we should take the assistance of these intelligence, but we should not hand over all our intelligence to them. That will be dangerous. So it is has got advantages and disadvantages. But the next step, what they are trying, they are showing in movies also, as sir has said in Robot, that the Pharaoh develops emotions and he goes up to the actress and what happens, they want to see the movie. So that thing, giving the control of taking decisions like human brain, that will be problematic in intelligence. Otherwise, it will be useful for so many things. For teaching purpose, whatever videos and all that is shown, that can be used as assistance to the educations. But that cannot replace what actually you are doing in anatomy hall or in surgery, OT. That is like if they are teaching you how to draw blood or how to do tracheostomy. That you can learn the steps and all that. But actually, you are supposed to do that in the ward. Then only you can understand and you can practice. So there is no way that we can substitute our natural intelligence, and that we have to remember and we should carry on. If you have got any questions, you can ask to the speakers. I'll give you 5 minutes for it.
So I have one article from Medscape. Recently they have done a survey of specialists in United States, what they think about the artificials. And if the panelists allow, we will see it. What exactly they think. Different questions they are asked today.
You can ask openly questions. I will give 5 minutes for there. After that, you can see that. Students should not hesitate anything.
Yes.
You ask openly, no problem. One or two questions at least.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, first year students, I think they are not that much in a mood to ask.
This is a MedStep done in 2023. The topic is AI, a health or concern. Next, please. Okay, next, please. Very interesting report. How our medical faculty, where AI is in the highest use, what they feel about this. Now 42% of the clinicians, they are enthusiastic, 30% neutral, 28% they are apprehensive about using the AI. Who are most enthusiastic? Cardiologists, radiologists. They were most enthusiastic person. In my opinion, they have numerical data on which they calculate the things. Who are little negative? Family physicians and pediatricians. They are negative about using the artificial intelligence at the workplace. Next. Now, this is about, according to age, in almost all, yes, doctors are interested in understanding the care. Next. Now, what are they saying about this AI future? What they are saying? A computer cannot replace one-on-one physician interaction with the patient, and like that, multiple responses are there. These are the predominant responses. I am a bit concerned about patient's privacy and misuse of technology. Why this misuse? Because you must have heard the news that the data of n number of patients was stolen from one premier institute. One more news was there that the sections and informations about brain tumors from MIMHANS was stolen by a researcher in probably in Kerala. This threat can be there. Next, please. Now, how doctors feel about AI driving diagnosis or treatment? Respondents were asked how concerned they were that AI could be substituted for their clinical judgment and expertise. 41% they say somewhat concerned. Okay, next. Any technology that lessens the importance of human to human contact in delivery of a patient care is worrisome. Dogi panelists ne atta mantla ki human to human contact ka bhayankar dhor paata sagya ani Sharma sir magashi sangat hote feel the pain of the person. Those to be there are great professionals. The potential for improved patient care and workflow is enormous, although the equal potential for abuse is prevalent. Next, please. How crucial is it for doctors to be informed on AI? 80% say yes, it is very important. Next, please. How medicine practice how medical practices already use AI? You will find that research, it is used electronic health record, it is used. Office administration task, it is used, and patient scheduling. Remember that even in US, AI is used predominantly for both these conditions, for research, for records, for administration and scheduling. And for others, they are treating the patient hardly in 5% of the cases they are using it, or to treat the patient. Next. Now, again, same in a graphical way. Next. What's the best approach for medical workplace to take on AI? Okay. The most common answer is, I would rather see physicians harness AI usage and efficiencies before the administrator. Remember this, the administrator, insurance companies and regulators, for their benefit, they will create an environment that AI is very important, because they have a business. And before it happens, remember that we should learn AI. That's why you should learn the benefits, you should learn the drawbacks, and you should come very prominently if the drawbacks are there. I don't want to say that future machines will have less drawbacks, no doubt about that. But you should come with a statement what you feel. Then, my patients get quality medical info from AI. 36% they say very nice. My daughter is working at a corporate hospital in Pune, in pediatrics and neonatology, and she always complains. In that hospital, most of the patients, they are from information technology, and they always complain. These parents, they come to me with a definitive diagnosis in their mind and a definitive treatment options in their mind. That way is going to make a problem due to AI. Next. Do doctors worry that patients will follow AI before them? Yes. It is happening in India also. Before going to doctor, they are screening the Google, they are making their own diagnosis. And more important nowadays, it is the WhatsApp advices which they are following. N number of different drugs, N number of naturopathies, N number of different diets, they are advised on WhatsApp for treating common cold as well as malignancies. Okay, yeah, that's a problem. Next. Now next is the Dr. Google has been a problem, just I said, Google is a problem in India also in some cities. AI responses sound confident even when the information is inaccurate. सगळ्यात महत्वाचं आहे की व्हॉट्सअपवाला एवढ्या कॉन्फिडेंट इन्फॉर्मेशन देतो ना की तुम्हाला वाटतं हा बघ हे काढा पाहिल्यावर माझा ॲक्रस करता 100% डिझॉल्व होणार म्हणजे होणार. सेम वॉज टू अबाउट इन कोविड. इन कोविड वी हॅव एन नंबर ऑफ डिफरंट ड्रग्स. देवर ॲडवाइज, देवर ॲडवाइज बाय लोकल्स, देवर ॲडवाइज बाय आयुर्वेद, देवर ॲडवाइज इवन बाय द WHO itself. It said chloroquine, then it said something else, and again said remdesivir, then said no, it is not useful. Next. Will AI affect risk for medical malpractice? Yes. For this they have given example of respiratory failure occurring in pneumonia and failure COP. They have analyzed the data, how much AI was able to accurately give the cause of respiratory failure as pneumonia, COPD or heart failure. In some cases it was true, but wrong interpretation was significantly there. Next. So this is another thing. A lot of physicians order labs and studies that are not critical for diagnosis in order to avoid malpractice. But here AI will help you to cut down some of that waste. Now, sir, I am not sure about this. If you have a question, you can ask me to ask you to ask me to ask you 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 to ask Now here they have is for some help. It will cut down unnecessary lab orders or investigations which are given. Thank you. Thanks for the
Thank you all the panelists. The discussion was surely an in-depth insight for our students. The floor is now open to the respected chairperson.
Everything already said by these speakers, they are with all their slides. But AI cannot replace a doctor, that I can tell you definitely. One example, Dr. Gardner sir told that AI can accurately diagnose XHS and tells it normal. XHS normal, not missing the patient, has no disease. A doctor only can tell that. Like for example, a case of bronchospasm, so much breathless, wheeze is there, that is not seen on X-ray. Initial small lesions of TB, that also not seen on X-ray. Sarcoidosis is normal. COPD initially, that is also not initially, the changes are not there, X-ray is normal. As pneumonia is concerned, and all that, that assessment of a human patient by a human doctor is far more accurate than the AI to assess the critical condition of the patient. A critical condition of patient, an experienced doctor of 25 years experience, from the when the patient enters in the clinic, that time only patient, we can say patient is bad. It is very difficult for to say the same thing by the AI. We have to scan all the data and all that. We don't scan the data. The moment the patient comes in the casualty, the walk, his face, his eyes, expression, from that only you can say this patient is very bad. He may die in 10 minutes. That patient is given priority. Such things cannot be replaced by the AI. So now this is open for discussion. I invite our students and the doctors here to ask patients freely without any hesitation.
Hello. In fact, I have, when Dr. Jaikar told me this morning that there is a CME on artificial intelligence, it is how I came to know, and I have come here to learn something about AI in medicine, because we are trying to conduct a CME on the same topic in a couple of months' time. So I am also curious to know how far this technology is useful, and I think looking at most of the things, AI can assist us. It cannot replace human brain, as Shakespeare said. It cannot replace the emotions. It cannot make think the way human mind can think. As you said, how to prioritize, what is emergency. It can only interpret what we feed into the machine. So it is up to us to use how to use this new technology. But having said that, it can definitely assist us, and it can reduce our burden. How to effectively we can learn in a better way, AI can assist us and help us, but it is unlikely to replace the human brain. Thank you.
So thank you, sir. Quickly. No questions? So I declare that this session is over. Thank you.
Now we request the chairperson to kindly come on the stage and felicitate our respected panelists. Sir, please. Thank you, sir. Moving on to the next session of the program.